Part 7. Appalachian, Valachi, Bananas, and Cuba. The police pretended it was sheer chance. A patrol car passing the remote mansion in Appalachian, New York, wondered why so many out-of-state cars were outside Mr. Barbara's house. State police rapidly zeroed in on the gathering, apparently never anticipating that their sirens and flashing blue lights would cause 58 elderly and middle-aged gentlemen to tumble out of the windows and run through the wet woods in their elegant wing-tipped shoes. When rounded up, they all gave the same explanation.
"I was just passing by, and I thought I'd drop in to pay my respects to my old friend Joe Barbara, since I heard he got heart trouble."
Gosh, what a lot of friends he had. And what various places they hailed from. Nearby Buffalo, distant Kansas City, sunny Florida, chilly New York. And what notorious names some of those New Yorkers bore. "Everyone's name in there ends in a vowel," as cops used to jeer at mobsters. "Genovese, Profaci, Bonanno, Gambino, Galante." A roster of major mafia dons. All rounded up because the statees just happened to wonder why all these cars. A quick look at who was missing showed that the raid was no accident. Appalachian was a criminal conference that the great Detroit and Chicago mobs boycotted. There was no representative of the recently retired but still very influential Frank Costello. Mayor Lansky, national financier of crime and now the most powerful crook in the continental USA, begged off because he had a sore throat. Vito Genovese had been set up. The would-be super don intended to tell the company that the hit on Albert Anastasia 3 weeks earlier had been approved by Lansky and Luciano, who acknowledged Albert's devoted loyalty to them, but agreed that he was becoming an embarrassment to everyone, and more particularly objected to his increasing demands that he be given a cut of the lucrative gambling action in Cuba which Lansky controlled. But Vito had taken on far smarter men than himself. Lansky, Luciano, and Costello tipped off the police that on November the 14th they might find some men they wanted to interview if they raided Barbara's estate. They coached Carlo Gambino, who'd inherited Anastasia's family, and he went, intending vocally to refuse would-be godfather Genovese either cash gifts or allegiance. They tipped off Sam Giancana, now controlling Chicago's interests, that he'd better not go. And he tipped off his favourite allies and satraps. Vito Genovese had egg all over his face for leading tutti other capi into arrest and ridicule. And the three real brains behind organised crime hadn't finished with him yet. Following Tom Dewey's example, they organised a pretty bum rap. They lured Genovese into an apparently big-scale dope deal. Then they bribed a low-grade street-level crook to go to the cops and testify against him. Serious mafia watchers seriously doubted the likelihood of a genuinely big man like Genovese having any close personal dealings with a little pissant pusher like Nelson Cantaloupes. But who cared? The law had again got their Mr. Big and shoved him in jail. As boss of all bosses, Genovese was seriously handicapped. And the mark of Lansky's genius. He never even suspected that the Luciano-Lansky-Costello combine had shafted him. From 1959 until his death 10 years later, Don Vito languished in Atlanta Penitentiary. In 1962, his cellmate, a very minor mafioso named Joseph Valachi, panicked. He believed Don Vito had him marked for assassination, and he battered another innocuous convict to death, wrongly fearing that he'd been nominated executioner. With conviction for that murder against him, coupled with the fear that Genovese might still have him whacked, Valachi ran to the law for protection, and for 2 months in 1963, America enjoyed the televised spectacle of Joseph Valachi telling a Senate subcommittee the history and inner workings of the mafia. His information was enthralling. Unlike Abe Reel's testimony, it led to no great arrests and convictions, although he named 317 mafiosi previously unknown to law enforcement. But Valachi clarified much that had been shadowy and uncertain. He had been inducted by Salvatore Maranzano in the 1920s. He fought in the Castellammarese War and was transferred to Lucky Luciano's family when it ended. Don Vito was now his capo, and he accorded him respect that amounted to awe. And he really knew who was and who had been who. Writers on organized crime were groping in the dark until Valachi set the record straight. Without him, these tapes would probably not exist, and if they did, would be full of ifs and buts and erroneous guesses. Valachi identified the five families and their successive bosses. Valachi told us all about the Castellammarese War and the post-war settlement. And as an old-timer inducted by Maranzano, Valachi described the macabre mafia rituals with crossed daggers and guns and drops of blood drawn from thumbs to seal brotherhood. He outlined the rigid codes of conduct enforced by death threats. Never raise a hand to a brother mafioso. Never lay a finger on a mafioso's wife, daughter, or sister. Live expensively but inconspicuously in a respectable suburb. Make sure your kids behave well and never draw adverse attention to you. The Hoods thought these things made them gentlemen of honour. Cynical observers noted that they were the way ordinary decent citizens behaved, without any threatening penalties, and showed how difficult it was to hold these bandits together as a united army, given their penchant for settling all differences with violence. Valachi taught us some new underworld slang, vig for the extortionate weekly interest extracted brutally by the shylocks, or loan sharks, going on the mattress for holing up in rented rooms during a gang war, going to the table for facing a serious disciplinary inquiry by your boss or the commission. The mafia put a $100,000 contract out on him, knowing that this publicity was bad publicity, even though much of Valachi's testimony was demonstrably overdramatized, and some of it was just plain wrong, like his belief that Genovese really was the boss of all bosses. One of his most suspect claims showed how right they were to think that even inaccurate information might work against them. After Appalachian, J. Edgar Hoover looked sillier and sillier in maintaining that there was no mafia. For most of the 50s, he had distracted attention by joining Joe McCarthy in red-baiting as a matter of supposedly greater importance. But McCarthy was dead, his ism generally recognized as a great evil. And former admirers of the director demanded that he remove his blinkers and now take on the mighty mafia rather than the minuscule Communist Party USA. Valachi got Hoover off the hook when he declared inaccurately that the entire organization was called La Cosa Nostra and not the mafia. La Cosa what? Was most people's response. It was unknown at the time that mafiosi in Sicily always internally referred to their own individual crime families with the innocuous phrase. Since it just means our thing, it gave away nothing to outside listeners. J. Edgar Hoover, it transpired, was the one man in America who was already familiar with the term. Of course he knew all about Cosa Nostra, he declared. The FBI had been keeping tabs on it all along. He just hadn't realized that was what people meant when they kept talking about a crime syndicate or a national crime commission or the mafia. It was a thin excuse, but it served. And with his public attitude reversed, Hoover now had to keep up serious investigation of the syndicate's activities. Worse, he was close to retirement age, and his successor would probably have to throw the full weight of the bureau into the battle. Valachi's revelations had another ill consequence. 1962 saw the natural deaths of Lucky Luciano and Joe Profaci. Joe Bananas was now the only surviving family head from the 1931 reorganization. Yet the nation was hearing from Valachi that the imprisoned upstart Vito Genovese was capo di tutti capi. Bonanno was furious. If anyone was to be boss of bosses, he should be. He decided to seize power by rubbing out Tommy Lucchese and Carlo Gambino, as well as gang bosses in Buffalo and Los Angeles. He left the job of killing the New York Cappy to his ally Giuseppe Magliocco, Joe Profaci's underboss, who had taken over command of the Profaci family. And Magliocco passed it on to his own underboss, Joe Colombo. Colombo ratted at once and reported the plot to the commission. Bonanno and Magliocco were summoned to the table. Bonanno contemptuously disregarded the order. Magliocco appeared and pleaded for his life. It was granted, but he was fined and stripped of his rank, and Colombo was made boss of the Profaci family as his reward for being a fink. He didn't command much respect, given the way he had come to power. The Gallo brothers continued their mattress war against him, and Colombo was kept busy dealing with them. So he didn't play much part in the desultory banana war that ran till 1968, as Joe was deposed and replaced by Gaspar Di Gregorio, who was quite unable to control Bonanno loyalists in the family, so had himself to be replaced by tougher Paul Sciacca, who nonetheless was still faced with occasional pro-Bonanno shootouts until a heart attack slowed down the old man, and for the second time Joe Bonanno's retired to Arizona. This time, finally. The New York Mafia was thus in rather poor shape during the 60s. But it got some rather good publicity when Mario Puzo fictionalized Fellacci's revelations in The Godfather. Though the prose sometimes descended to novelettish erotica, sympathetic human faces were put on the fascinating mobsters. And Marlon Brando put icing on the cake in his virtuoso film enactment of a capo di tutti capi who, like Profaci and Bananas, had been in place since the old days, like Tommy Lucchese handled his gang and neighbourhood with consummate authority and tact, and like Carlo Gambino led a quiet private life growing roses and tomatoes on Long Island, all in all a rather impressive old gentleman. The follow-up film, Godfather II, even proposed a fantastic and impossible route to power for him, as a poor man forced into non-violent crime who justifiably kills the local ganglord for oppressing little competitors, be they legal or illegal, only to find the act has turned him into a successful gang boss. As you have seen, capos have only ever become capos after blood-stained careers of multiple murder and deep treachery. By contrast to the disorganized New Yorkers, the Chicago mob under Sam Giancana was flying giddily high. For the first time ever, they thought they'd got a president in their pocket. Toward the end of Prohibition, Joseph P. Kennedy Sr. made some shrewd investments in the liquor trade, which was obviously about to become lucrative above ground. He wasn't really a major bootlegger, as is sometimes suggested, but he seemed close enough to them to be trusted. So Sam Giancana turned a favourable ear to a request from Frank Sinatra, who had kept up his admiring relationship with mobsters ever since the Havana Conference of 1946. Sinatra was a friend of Massachusetts Senator Jack Kennedy's brother-in-law, Peter Lawford, and he separately introduced both the senator and the gangster to Hollywood actresses and hopefuls who aimed to further their careers by bed-hopping with powerful men. When Jack Kennedy ran for the presidency, Sinatra urged Giancana to throw the mob's weight behind him, and Mooney agreed to help old Joseph P.'s son. His help may have been decisive. In the very close-run contest with Richard Nixon, late declaring Illinois proved crucial, and Illinois was swung to Kennedy by less votes than the plurality in Cook County, Capone's old stamping ground, where, at Giancana's behest, the registered dead voted, and voted early, and voted often for Kennedy. With Kennedy as president, both Sinatra and Giancana anticipated extraordinary favours, and both were disappointed. For one thing, JFK's brother Robert, now Attorney General, had hated the mobs ever since, as special counsel to a Senate committee in the 50s, he had uncovered the damage they did to the labour movement. He now ordered the FBI to put the heat on all racketeers and their ally in the corrupt Teamsters Union, Jimmy Hoffa. Giancana had the more reason to be annoyed, as he was now actually collaborating with a government agency. He and the US government shared a common enemy in Fidel Castro. Prior to 1959, Cuban dictator Fulgencio Batista was happy to let American gangsters run casinos in Havana and make all the profit they liked. Mayor Lansky was his personal friend and invested $3 million in a personal bribe to Batista. The mobs tried to safeguard their interests by donating a little cash to Castro's rebel army in case they should win and come to power. But when this happened, they were appalled to discover that the new master of Cuba meant it when he declared Cuba for the Cubans and proposed a cleaner, healthier society in which the urban poor did not have to make their living by grovelling service to rich tourists and the prostitution of their daughters. By the end of 1960, Lansky had fled the island, and his gaming interests were reduced to George Raft, his film career definitely over, standing miserably outside the one remaining casino and begging the few tourists to come in and lose their money. A year later, he'd been chucked out, and the whole Cuban gambling business was over. The mobs had lost $500 million or more in annual profits, their most profitable venture anywhere. But Uncle Sam, too, decided against Castro after he confiscated the holdings of the U.S. Fruit Company and gradually made clear his sympathy with communism. The Eisenhower administration allowed the CIA to plan the invasion of Cuba by anti-Castro exiles. When Kennedy came to office, this plan was in place and ready to run. The new president accepted assurances that it was safe, and the result, as everyone knows, was the disastrous defeat of the invading force at the Bay of Pigs. Kennedy was irresponsibly furious with everyone for this tarnishing of his pristine image. Alan Dulles's head rolled, and the experience and astuteness of the CIA's founder was lost to it. Castro became a Kennedy bête noire, and the CIA entered into really foolish discussions with mafia chiefs about getting rid of Fidel. While Mayor Lansky had lost most to Castro, it was Chicago's man, Johnny Rosselli, who became the principal CIA contact. He was now living in Florida and clearing all plans to reopen the business in Cuba with the local chieftain, Santos Traficante. But for the CIA's benefit, he pulled in his own boss, Sam Giancana, and the mobsters accepted some advance payments for attempted hits on Fidel Castro. The proposed plans included some utterly daft ideas, like an exploding cigar or a strong depilatory that should make Castro's hair and beard fall out, thus it was hoped robbing him of the charisma that bound his people to him. But there were more serious discussions about poisoning him. And given Vito Genovese's success in having Pete LaTempa poisoned while in protective custody, they were more dangerous. Fortunately, the mafiosi seemed to have done nothing. But cynically recognizing the CIA negotiators as a set of cowboys with boys' own paper notions of spying, pocketed their money and sat on their hands. At the same time, Sam Giancana and President Kennedy were both enjoying the good offices of Frank Sinatra and Peter Lawford to usher pretty girls from Hollywood into their beds. Both would ultimately boast of sleeping with Marilyn Monroe. Though Giancana's single rape of her unconscious drunken body at a party hardly constituted a great love affair. More seriously, a young lady called Judith Campbell regularly shared the beds of both president and gangster. Years later, as Mrs. Exner, she claimed to have delivered messages in sealed envelopes from Giancana to the White House. Whatever the truth of this, the mobs certainly gained inside knowledge of the president's extensive bedroom activities at a time when the public saw his marriage to Jacqueline Bouvier as an exemplary Catholic match between beautiful people with wealth, wit, and taste. Mobsters would later claim that they'd even bugged Marilyn Monroe's bedroom and secured tapes of the president making love to her. They were not, however, entirely discreet about their knowledge, and it leaked back to J. Edgar Hoover. The FBI director instantly warned the president that his socialization with Sinatra and girlies introduced by his circle must stop before the public discovered that the White House was being tarnished by mob associations. The old man was privately delighted to have this blackmailing hold over Kennedy, who he knew despised him and would have liked to demand his resignation as soon as it was politically safe. Sinatra was furious when Kennedy dropped him like a hot brick, and the former Democrat supporter became a Republican. Giancana and other mafia chiefs muttered vengeful threats in their normal brutal language. But the dangerous inter-involvement of government and mafiosi was over by the time the president was assassinated. It remained for Mayor Lenski and the New Yorkers to try and recover outlets for laundering money as good as the old Havana casinos had been. Their first abortive move was to London.